Hi guys, I'm Alex and
I'm Mira. You can call me that for short. We're working on the NativeScript team in Sofia. We're based in Bulgaria. And we traveled here to talk about optimizations and how to make your NativeScript Angular apps start faster. So today we're going to talk about a few techniques that you can use, such as lazy loading and Webpack, and also three other Webpack plugins that will allow you to ahead of time compile your code, run it through uglify.js, and make heap snapshots out of it. Also, through the session, we'll show you a few profiling tools. So, because we're currently working on the NativeScript Angular integration, we're pretty excited, and we want to ask you, who have you used Angular with NativeScript? Cool. All right, cool. I can't count, but someone will tell me how many after that. So, for those who raised their hands, can anyone tell me which of these five optimizations are Angular specific? Come on.
AOT,
that's right. And
lazy
loading. And lazy loading.
That's great.
Thanks. That was easy. All right. Now, a bit harder question. Which of these three left optimizations is Android specific? All right, that's the V8 heap snapshots. That's because we're using V8 for our Android runtime, and we're using another JavaScript engine. That's the JavaScript core for our iOS runtime. But we'll get into that. So now that we know what we're going to do, let's see which is the app we're going to optimize.
So the app we are going to look into today is the simplified version of the NativeScript SDK examples. And if you haven't seen this app, it's like a screen with a bunch of examples. And when you navigate to the examples, you get a page with UI widgets that is built in the site NativeScript. And they are really, really pretty, really easy to use. And what we got here is that we profiled the application. And even for the simplified version, it took around 13 seconds to start up on an old Android phone. But still, Nexus 5 is an old phone, but still 13 seconds is a lot. And remember, this is only the simplified version. For the original version, we don't know how much time because it's still loading, but it was pretty much. And few words about the architecture of the application. It has a root application module, and it has a bunch of feature modules with the different examples. And in the initial state that we're going to look into, all the feature models are loaded inside the application model. So no lazy loading, but we didn't know better back then when we developed it. So our goal here is to reach 3 seconds, and we'll be happy.
So how do we do that? We have 13 seconds of startup time, but we have almost no clue what's happening in these 13 seconds. So we need to do some profiling now. For that, we're going to use the timeline view. That's a tool that we released in the latest version of NativeScript. And first, the first thing we need to do is just add the profiling key with value timeline in our app package.json. Then we need to install the timeline view from npm. And we can install it globally because we can use it for all our NativeScript applications. After that, we just need to run our app on a real device and pipe the output to timeline view. We'll see a pretty verbose output that's actually traces from all the functions that are executing inside the framework. After we kill the process, after our app is loaded, we can kill it with Control-C or whatever, the timeline will output an HTML file in our project. When we open the HTML file, we see something like that. That's a flame chart, and it's basically a timeline what's happening when we load our app. So here, the blue boxes are code that's executed in the Android runtime. That's our code that's executed in JavaScript, the blue boxes. And the yellow boxes are code that's executed in the Android runtime. So what happens step by step? First, we're bootstrapping our Android runtime for 4.3 seconds. And part of that is the extracting of the app on the device. It happens only the first time that we install the app on the device and we start it. After that, that 2.3 seconds for the extraction of the app are gone, only the first one. So after we bootstrap the runtime, we start loading JavaScript modules. We start from our entry module, the main.js, And part of that is the NativeScript Angular framework and the app module, our root module. And these two chunks actually recursively wrote everything that's imported inside them. So because we have all our feature modules imported in the app module, they're also wrote here. Then the Android activity is born. And then Angular does some magic. And because that's some code inside the Angular framework, we haven't instrumented it. And the only thing we see here is our garbage collection process running. That takes almost 2 seconds, and we'll see later on, almost in the end, how to optimize that process. The last thing that happens is just rendering and showing our beautiful user interface. But let's go back on the loading of Angular modules. As Alex mentioned previously, we're importing all the feature modules in our app module. But we don't really have to do that, because that causes Angular to compile all the modules as startup and render them. Everything we need as startup, as we saw previously, is just a list view with a couple of examples. So what we can do about it? You already know the answer. You're smart guys.
So we are going to do lazy loading. So everybody knows lazy loading, what it is. It's just a way of the Angular to load modules when you need them. So in our case, when you actually navigate to the pages with the examples, we only then need to load the modules. And we're going to show you how to lazy load one of the modules, and we're going to do that for the rest of them. So we're going to do the lazy loading in 4 steps. So the first step is to provide a NativeScript module factory loader. And you need to do that only once in your application. The way you do that is you import the ng module factory loader class from Angular core. You import our implementation, the NativeScript implementation of module factory loader from the NativeScript Angular plugin. And you just provide it inside your application module. So that's all you need to do. You can do it once for your application. And basically, the NS module factory loader tells Angular how to load lazily modules inside a NativeScript application. Okay. So the second step is just admit that we were wrong in the first place to include all these modules inside the app module and just remove all the imports. So we don't need the import of the JavaScript module, and we don't need to register the feature modules inside our ng module. The next step, actually the two left steps are related to configuring the router. And the first thing we need to do is just use load children instead of children in our app root configuration. So instead of loading, using children for the button routes, we can use just load children and pass in a string specifying where the module is actually located inside the application. And here after the hashtag, we should specify the name of the module will be lazy loading. And the final step is actually inside the feature module that is going to be lazy loaded. We must provide all the routes. All the routes so that when Angular lazy loads this module, all the routes that are inside this feature module should be loaded inside the Angular router so that it knows how to navigate in the pages inside this feature module. And we do that with the forkchild method of the NativeScript router module. Okay, so this is pretty standard stuff. And what we get out of this is almost 3 seconds faster startup time, which is like pretty good first steps. But we need to do that for all the models, of course. And the moral of the story is just be lazy and fetch the modules later. And just do that from the start to save you their factoring. And so what's next? We saw that in the timeline view, we are loading a lot of files. Like we have a quite deep require stack. And maybe we can do something about it. I know if we had a fewer files, I don't know, Mira?
Yeah, we can use something like Webpack, which is a module bundler. So we can start for a single entry module and just build a dependency graph for all the JavaScript modules we use in our application, and then just bundle them into several files. instead of requiring thousands of JavaScript files and making a lot of requests for the file system, we're just going to make several requests. And we're going to load 10 or 15 JavaScript modules instead of thousands of them. So that's pretty much what Webpack does. Who uses Webpack? Ooh. All right, I see the pain. Me too. So Webpack, when you use it with NativeScript in a standard way that we're going to show, comes with ahead of time mode of the Angular compiler. So yeah, Angular has a compiler. It's used to compile the components and their templates into executable JavaScript that's optimized to be faster. And it comes in two modes. The just-in-time mode compiles the templates if you're using the app. When you're navigating somewhere, when you're just exploring the application, the compiler is run and it compiles your components and their templates. But if you run the compiler in ahead-of-time mode, that compilation happens while you're building the app. And with Webpack, that's the default state. So what you get is a pre-compiled and pretty fast application, fast because it doesn't have the Angular compiler anymore. And the Angular compiler is almost a megabyte big stuff. So you ship the app that's pre-compiled to your users, and you instantly gain faster app. Well, how do we enable Webpack after all that we said? The easiest way is just to use the NativeScript Dev Webpack plugin as a development dependencies. And because it has several other NPM plugins to your project, you need to run NPM install once again. So after we do that, we should use several NPM scripts to bundle our application. One of them is built Android bundle. The same for iOS, of course, is built iOS bundle. And let me show you how to do that. First, as I said, I need to install NativeScript Dev Webpack. NPMI is just a shorthand for NPM install, and dash D is the same as save dev. So do you see OK? I can zoom a little bit. That's for later, yeah. So here we're installing NativeScript Dev Webpack. And as I said, it will add several other things to our project. Let's see what happens. We see some new files here. We will talk about some of them later, but they're pretty much Webpack configurations that you may need to modify for your application, and you need to keep them under source control. Also, we saw that NativeScript Dev Webpack did something to our package.json. Let's see what happens. So we have several new dependencies. And these are pretty much some Webpack plugins that are used in the configuration. So we need to run npm install once again, just to install everything that the plugin did. And after that, as I said, we're going to use some NPM scripts instead of the NativeScript CLI to bundle our app with Webpack. All right. So one such script that we can use is npm run build Android bundle. So we can use start instead of build, and that will ship the app to our device or our emulator if it's connected. And you can use build, and the result will be ready to use a shippable application. So we can, for example, for iOS, go to Xcode and just release the output, the archive that's produced from Webpack. So here we see Webpack running. It's bundling all of our modules. And probably the first thing everyone saw when installed Webpack is how it fails miserably. All right, so because this is an NPM script, we don't see the actual error here. We see a lot of things, but not the actual error. So we need to scroll a little bit, like a few screens, and we see some errors here. So what are these errors? So these are errors from the Angular ahead of time compiler. Because the compilation is happening at build time, the compiler is much stricter. So let's see how we can fix these errors. The first one we have in our tap event component. We have a single method that's declared on tap, and it accepts zero parameters. However, in our components template, we are invoking that method and we are providing one argument. We don't actually need that argument because we are not using it. And of course, you can do that in JavaScript, but the ahead of time compiler of Angular is complaining. So what we need to do is just drop that argument. And we won't see any errors. Actually, there's one more error. So it's again in the same component. We have a private property that's title background. And we're binding it to our core attributes in our template. So everything that we're trying to bind to in our template should be public in our class declaration. The simple solution is just to make that public. All right, so I don't want to see these errors at build time when I'm trying to apply Webpack. What I can do is just use some other tools like CodeAdvisor and the Angular language service, which is available as a VS Code extension. Like that, I can see these errors while I'm developing the app instead of when I'm building it. So let's get back on our build. Let's imagine that I already fixed the errors. And I'll just jump to another tag in my project. So I have several new files, so I just have to discard them. I'll stash them for later. And I'll never get back to them, but never mind. So here, my workspace is clean now, so I can jump to the Webpack tag. Here I have fixed all my errors. I already have the Webpack plugin installed, so everything I need to do is just build my application. So just to get back on what that script is doing, it's running the NativeScript CLI with prepare to prepare our native Android project. Then it's using Webpack as a child process to bundle our JavaScript files and our assets. It's shipping them inside the platforms directory. You probably know that. All of you developed NativeScript applications, so Webpack just outputs the JavaScript files in our platforms directory. And then we run the NativeScript CLI once again to build the native project and to ship it to our device if we want to. So that's what's happening. It's a simple JavaScript script, node script. And as you can see, it's taking some time. It's clearly slower than the default way, and we don't have live sync here yet. So we built our app, and it's ready to use. I won't start it right now, but I'll see what happened to my working space. So I have some new directory here. It's called reports. If I go inside, I'll see that I have two files, report.html and stats.json. We'll see later how this happens. It's just a simple Webpack plugin that outputs that report, and we'll use it later to analyze it. All right, so what happens when we start our app that's Webpacked? We see pretty big difference of more than 5 seconds. The first thing that's gone is the extracting of almost all the application assets. That's because the Angular compiler, which is pretty big, is gone. And the assets are smaller because they are fewer. That affects also the requiring of JavaScript files. We're not requiring thousands of files right now. We're requiring only 10. We'll see why there are 10 and not one later on. And of course, the ahead of time compilation helped us get rid of that chunk that's the Angular compiler running while we're starting the app. So that's the result, faster app. But we can go further. As I can see, that chunk, the requiring of JavaScript modules, is taking a second and a half. What we can do is just run our code, JavaScript code, through some minification process and make it smaller. We can use Uglify.js for that. Because there is a cool wrapper for Webpack, we can just use the Uglify.js plugin. And because we have a cool Webpack plugin ourselves, we provide that by default. And you can trigger the Uglify.js build with a simple flag. So after we do that, we gain some time. Half a second, yeah. All right, what we can do more? We can profile again. remember the report directory I told you about? That's actually coming from the Bundle Analyzer plugin. That's a Webpack plugin that's included in your Webpack configuration by default, if you install our plugin, of course. So every time you build a Webpack application, you get that report in your in your working directory. You don't have to keep that into source control. It's purely for your use. So if we open the report HTML file, we'll see a pretty cool heat map here. All right, what's happening here? The code colors in our picture are actually our app code. On the top, we see our bundle.js file. That's actually our entry module. We're loading that at startup. The other chunks are actually other JavaScript files, and these are the modules that we configure to be lazily loaded. So when we navigate to a page that contains a lazily loaded module, that's when we are going to require that files. So for example, if 3.js is some module that we navigate to, then it will be required from the file system, and it's not on startup. The biggest part of our app is vendor.js. It contains some external modules. By default, we configure it to contain NativeScript Angular, our core modules, and of course the Angular framework. As you can see, it's almost half of the application. So what we can do about it? We're also loading that at startup time because it's some kind of a common chunk. All of the other JavaScript files, if they import something from NativeScript Angular, for instance, they're going to require that from vendor.js. So that's something we're loading at startup. Actually, we're loading vendor.js before every other JavaScript file because we need to execute that code there. It should be ready for use. So what we can do about it?
OK, so I get to talk about the cool stuff. So how many of you know about the V8 snapshot, heap snapshot feature? OK, just a few hands. So I'll explain a little bit what a V8 heap snapshot actually does. So if I take an empty instance of V8, feed it with a JavaScript file, and let it compile, parse, and execute this file, then you can take a snapshot of the heap of the memory of the application at that state and save it to a blob file. And later on, you can start another V8 instance and just feed it this blob file, and it will automatically load all the heap snapshot in memory as it was it loaded the file itself. So it's a really cheap trick to preload some of your JavaScript files upfront in your application. And we are using that for NativeScript for Android, and we are doing a snapshot of the vendor chunk. Build time, we have a Webpack plugin that does that, and we are shipping the vendor chunk blob file inside the APK that goes inside your application, and when you start the Android application, we just load the snapshot inside the V8. So that's really cool, and however, there's one limitation. Because we are doing that build time, we don't have an access while we are building the application with Webpack. We don't have the access to all the native APIs. So you're not allowed to access call native methods, like for example Android widget button or some of the other native APIs inside this snapshot model. So that's a limitation that we have to look for, but luckily there's an easy workaround for this limitation. You can just wrap the native calls inside a function that gets executed when your application is actually running, not in the script that you're loading in the snapshot. And basically, that's the snapshot feature. How to enable it? As I said, it's really easy because we pre-configured the Webpack config with our plugin that does all the job. All you need to do is pass the snapshot argument to the build script, and instantly you have the improvement of like a half a second or even more to your application startup time. And what's interesting to see here that the loading of the vendor chunk disappeared because it's what's loaded as a snapshot, as a heap snapshot, instead of V8 having to parse and compile the file at runtime. OK, so we are already under 3 seconds, but that's not enough because we have a new toy to play with, the V8 snapshots. So we need to exploit that deeper. Like, how to make use of this tool even more. And basically, we have two approaches, and we can take both. One of them is to move as much code from the bundle.js. Remember, that was our main entry of the application, to the vendor.js, because the vendor.js is actually the file that gets snapshotted, and the code that's moved there basically is not compiled at runtime and not executed at runtime in your application. It comes directly from the snapshot. And the other thing that we can do is move common code from the lazy loaded chunks to the vendor chunk. So this will not actually improve the startup time of our application, but we will improve the navigation between the pages after that, because our lazy chunks will be loaded faster. They will be smaller. Also, this will reduce the whole application size because we won't have duplicating code. We'll see that in a while. And OK, let's start with the first option, because it will give us a performance boost for the startup. If we explore the bundle.js, we can see that it's almost a megabyte, and almost half of it is the RxJS library. So this might be a familiar slide from the previous talk, but OK, we managed to include somehow the whole RxJS library in our main bundle. And we're going to use a tool that will help answer and profile additionally our application, because the bundle analyzer, the report we are generating, is pretty good at telling us what's inside our different chunks, but it's not that good at telling us why a particular model is in particular chunk. So we're gonna use another tool, which is actually an online application provided by the Webpack. By the way, does anybody have used this tool before? Okay, so you learned something new. So you open the site and you just feed it the status.json file that we generated earlier, along with the report.js, and just we're going to load the modules. And while we're enjoying this view, I'll just tell you a little bit more about the status.json. Basically, when the Webpack builds your application, it goes through all the modules, starting from the entry points and loads all the JavaScript modules. And it's built this highly complicated graph of all the JavaScript files that it's traversed. And along with the dependencies, it also provides a little metadata for each model, so that we can use tools like that to explore what happened in the Webpack build. And if I go here to the chunks tab, I can see all my application chunks. And this big dot here is actually the vendor.js, the biggest one. And you can see why it's called a common model, because it's important in all the other chunks. And the other orange dot here is our main bundle. That's the bundle we actually want to optimize right now. So if I click on it, I can see again the graph with all the modules. But the modules, the JavaScript modules that are inside this bundle are black. And instantly, I can see the problem here, like this big nest of black dots that can be good, like so many modules. And I don't know if you can see, but this is actually the RxJS library that we suspected as something evil in our application. And if I scroll down a bit, I can see the meta information about this module. And the most important, I can see the reasons why this module actually got inside this chunk. And that's why that's because I'm importing it, requiring it inside my app component, yes. OK, so it's this tool is really useful when you want to track why a particular module is inside a particular chunk. And the other thing I can explore here is that this RxJS model actually has a ton of dependencies. I can scroll like for ages here, and these are all the modules that it loads on itself. And if I scroll to the down to the bottom, I can see the actual code of this module. So you can see why this tool is really powerful. And if I go back to the presentation, you saw that coming, right? You should not import the whole RxJS library in your application. Just never do that. Import only the operators you need. Just just do it. And actually, a good practice is to have a RxJS operators file, or you can name it whatever you want, but a common file that you can import your all the operators you gonna need in your application. So the good why is it good practice? It's a good practice because you don't have to import all those operators in your files when you're actually using them. You can import them in a single file. And once you import them in a single file, it makes sense to include that file in the vendor chunk, okay? So that's what we are aiming for. We want to put more stuff in the vendor chunk because it's a subject of the heap snapshot. And I'll tell you how to do that. Actually, when we installed Webpack, one of the files that was generated was this app vendor TS file, and it's the entry point of the vendor chunk. So that's it. We can just require the RxJS operators file here inside the vendor TS file, and it automatically goes inside the vendor chunk. Okay? The result? The result is obvious. We have the RxJS library inside the vendor chunk, and inside the bundle.js, we don't have RxJS anymore because it's part of the common model now. And of course, we can do that for other models. For example, the NativeScript animation, Angular animations module is also a model that can be moved to the vendor chunk. And as we saw, it's really easy to do that. It's safe because it doesn't execute any native code. So you can snapshot it. And when you do that, we can see that our bundle.js can become only 50 kilobytes, and the startup time is now 2.6 seconds. So I'm pretty happy about it. Let's explore the other approach. What can you do to optimize the common chunks? Remember, this won't affect the startup time, but it will affect the navigation performance when you're navigating inside the application. So let's see what's inside those nasty lazy loaded chunks. The one thing that immediately pops out, I mean, if you are watching this for a few weeks, like I did, you should immediately see that there's a common chunk, a common module that's important in all the lazy loaded chunks, and that is the NativeScript list view. And that's because each of the feature models actually holds a list with the examples in these feature models. And this list is actually the list view from NativeScript. And what we can do about it, so no surprise, we can include it in the vendor chunk. The list view is also written in such a way that it's snapshotable, so you won't get into trouble with that. And our lazy model chunk, lazy loaded chunks are now down to 50 kilobytes. The last thing we're going to do for now is just, if you're developing Angular application, probably you have a shared model, and probably you use the components from the shared model in your feature models. So it's a good idea to move the shared model inside the vendor chunk. And if you have a shared model, you usually have an index.ts file that holds all the references to the component directives and pipes for this shared model. So you can just import the index.ts file inside the vendor.ts. And when you do that, our lazy loaded chunks are even smaller. And we can do that even more, but you get the point, right? You want to put as much stuff as you can inside the vendor.js because it gets snapshotted. And the final result is that we drop the time, the startup time, from 2.9 seconds to 2.6 seconds. All the stuff that we did with the lazy modules didn't affect the startup time because the snapshot is really fast. It's just a binary. And what we can do next?
Well, we have one more thing for you today. And this is the new experimental thing we're working with, optimizing the garbage collection process. You can basically disable the mark reachable objects that we see here. And you can do that by providing single key in your app package.json. That's marking mode known. As I said, this is experimental, but it may become default in later versions. Now you can just play with it in your apps. You should at least use the latest version of NativeScript for it, 3.1. And also, there's a very cool blog post in the resources that you can find later. So what happens when we disable the mark reachable objects? We get a startup time of 2 seconds on a 4-year-old phone. And basically, that's all for us, all from us today. And yeah, 2 seconds. We started from 13 to 2. So yeah, thanks.
Pretty good, right?
Yeah.
All right, now just to wrap up, a few suggestions for you, just to sum up the whole session. First, use a timeline view to profile your application, because every single application write is a special little snowflake, and there may be different things that slows you, and you just need profiling tools to find out why it's slow. Also, just use lazy loading if you're developing Angular apps. Do it from the beginning and try not to refactor 40 ng modules later. I've done that. It's not funny. All right, so what else? Use Webpack, Uglify, and Snapshot for release builds, and set up some continuous integration to check if the Webpack builds are working, actually. You can do that on each commit. That's what we do in the NativeScript team. But if you're more adventurous, you can do that every night and see what you messed up the previous day. Also, don't use Webpack for debug builds, because it's slower currently than the debug builds, and we have no live sync for Webpack. But that is probably something we're currently working on, and you may be surprised in a few months. And the final thing, just use the tools that Alex showed, the bundle analyzers, to optimize the assets that are produced from the Webpack build. Just extract everything common to the vendor JS chunk and make the lazy loaded chunks as small as possible. So that's from us. You can find the slides here. There's the links this time. And you can ask us questions if there's some time left. All right, no questions? Okay, I'm just.
Question. Can we also lazy load that kind of native things?
Yeah, you can lazy load native script native things if you're using them in a native in a lazy model. They will be bundled with this lazy model, so you can this will happen automatically.
Lazy load that the module that we are triggering that native library. The native library also will lazy load automatically, right?
Yeah. Okay, so the question is moving things to the vendor JS gonna affect performance in iOS? Yeah. So the answer is in iOS, pretty much the performance is most of the times better. I think all of the times the startup time is much better. And basically, what happens in startup, the common chunk, the vendor JS is loaded, and the bundle JS is loaded. So they are both loaded in iOS, and there is no heap snapshots there. So it doesn't matter if the code is inside the one bundle or inside the other, because they're both going to be loaded. So it won't affect the performance in iOS.
I can give you another suggestion if you're moving code from the lazy chunks, which are not loaded at startup. You can do that not in the vendor TS file, but rather there are a few other tools, files, like vendor platform iAndroid. So that will add the files only for Android. And if you're building for iOS, the files you required in vendor platform Android will just stay in the lazy chunks. So that's one thing you can do.